Good evening, everyone. My name is Christiane Hoffman. I'm the director here at America House. I want to welcome you all here this evening. It's really great to have you here. Tonight we're going to be discussing a very important and also challenging, controversial topic that is post-traumatic stress disorder and the realities of returning home from the ATO zone. So for us at America House, it's really an honor to be hosting this event, to be serving as a platform for this important discussion. The purpose of the event is to raise awareness about the psychological effects of war, to look at resources available for those returning from the war, and to hear lessons learned from soldiers from the U.S. side and also from the Ukraine side. So right now I'd like to introduce our moderator for tonight's event, that is Nolan Peterson. Nolan is a Ukraine-based American journalist, a former U.S. Air Force Special Operations pilot, and a combat veteran from Iraq and Afghanistan. He was actually here this summer speaking on his experiences in the ATO zone, so it's really great to have you back, Nolan, and welcome to America House.
Thanks. So good evening, and first off, I'd like to thank America House for offering the venue for tonight's event, and thank you to all of you for taking time out of your busy schedules to come and learn a little bit more about this very important topic. We have a great panel gathered with us tonight, comprising a wide variety of experiences related to post-traumatic stress and the challenges that soldiers face when they come home from war. I think we're all going to learn something tonight, myself included, and I'm excited to hear what our panelists have to say. So before I get going with my opening remarks, I thought I'd have the panelists go through and introduce themselves real quick.
My name is Viktor Kovalenko. I'm a Ukrainian journalist, and I was also for a year serving in the Ukrainian army as a reservist officer, and I was in Debaltseve with my battalion, 40 infantry battalion. So thank you, Nolan, for inviting me to this panel discussion.
My name is Ivona Kostyna. I'm the vice chairman in Pobratim organization and the project manager of Sector V, a social adaptation program for veterans returning from combat in Ukraine. I've started as a volunteer delivering supplies to the army in 2014, and since January 2015, I'm working on the program together with my colleagues. Thank you.
Good evening. Roman Torgivitsky. I'm founder of Wounded Warrior Ukraine. We are running a program that helps veterans to move from post-traumatic syndromes to overcoming their own war trauma, and then providing peer-to-peer support to other veterans, and then moving on to becoming leaders of the society.
Great. You guys can keep the mic there. And like was mentioned in the opening, my name is Nolan Peterson. I'm an American journalist. I've been living in Ukraine off and on now for about a year and a half, covering the conflict in the Donbass. Before I was a journalist, like was mentioned, I was a pilot for Air Force Special Operations, and I saw combat in Iraq and Afghanistan. And I've actually been back to both of those wars now as a journalist. And through all those experiences, I can say that I have post-traumatic stress. And I'm not reluctant or hesitant to admit that. And in fact, I see it as a badge of honor, because in a way, it's something that links me to all of the Ukrainian and American, and even the Swedish soldiers that I've met throughout my life. Post-traumatic stress has nothing to do with how tough you are, how brave you are, or how strong you are. In fact, some of the toughest soldiers I've ever met, including Navy SEALs, Army Green Berets, they're the ones who suffer the most from post-traumatic stress. And one of the most important points that I hope comes out of tonight's discussion is that post-traumatic stress is a normal reaction to combat. It's the unavoidable result of your body's defense mechanisms to extreme stress, sort of like getting a sunburn if you've spent too much time at the beach. And by the way, many people refer to post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, but I prefer to call it post-traumatic stress, without the disorder part, because there's nothing abnormal about it. Like I said, it's natural and it's normal. But it took me a long time to recognize these symptoms and to feel comfortable enough to seek help For years, I struggled with relationships, and it affected my career at times, and it distanced me from family and friends. And I see that pattern repeating itself here in Ukraine. And I think it's important to openly discuss these issues, to teach soldiers that it's okay to come forward and seek help, and teach family and friends what their soldier is going to experience as they come back from war and try to reintegrate into civilian life. And the ultimate goal, of course, is for all Ukrainians to be able to enjoy the peace that the soldiers have fought so hard to achieve. Ukraine has a lot of challenges ahead related to soldiers reintegrating into civilian life, and we'll hear about those challenges tonight thanks to our panelists. But there's also a lot of good work being done by some very passionate and talented people to address these challenges. We're going to hear about that as well. Before I hand it over to the panel and start asking them questions, what I'd like to do is read the closing paragraphs of an article I wrote last winter about post-traumatic stress. And this article resonated with the veterans community back in America and is actually being used by some doctors in the Veterans Administration as part of their treatment programs for post-traumatic stress. And it sort of outlines what I think really what the truth of post-traumatic stress is. And I'd like to share it with you, so bear with me for a couple minutes here. Combat veterans are not broken, and they are not victims. They should not be pitied or looked upon with a sad shaking of the head or some reflexive, geez, what a shame. Pitying them belittles their experiences and misrepresents the challenges they face after military life. Combat veterans have experienced a spectrum of emotions whose breadth supersedes by a number you cannot imagine the emotional fluctuations of civilian life. That's why it's hard to care about normal things when you come back. Ask a combat veteran about this. It's a very common feeling. Normal life seems silly and pointless. It's a gray rerun that leaves you feeling hollow. You live on a razor's edge, only skipping across the surface of life, never returning to the heights or the depths of what you felt in war. But post-traumatic stress is not nostalgia. Nostalgia is just forgetting the bad parts of a memory, and you never forget the bad parts of war. The pain of losing a friend, or the images of the dead, reflect in everything you see and echo in everything you hear in peace. Yet even in times of comfort, you find yourself missing the hardships of war. The tough times at least made you feel something, and that's what you miss the most. Feeling truly alive. But how does that make sense? Why do the fantasies that sustained us through the toughest times of our lives seem like such a disappointment when we come home to live them? Maybe, for those who have been to war, the metric by which you measure pleasure and pain is permanently reset. You're not sad, you're just flat. You start to lust for the feelings to which you didn't realize you were addicted, but required the worst experience of your life to achieve. You grow resentful of those who go about their lives indifferent to your wartime experiences and the sacrifices of the brothers and sisters with whom you've served. You see reflections of your wartime experience in every part of life, and you wonder, knowing what you know now, how those around you can live the way they do. That is post-traumatic stress. Combat veterans are not damaged. They are enlightened, complicated souls, forced to live life by a set of rules and expectations that can make pursuing true happiness feel like chasing the moon. And for those who ultimately descend into a darkness from which they cannot save themselves, it was not war that broke them. It was a peace to which they returned, but never found. And so with that, I'd like to start tossing some questions with the panelists. And since today marks the one-year anniversary of the end of the battle for Debaltseve, I thought I'd start with Viktor Kovalenko, who is a veteran of that battle. So Viktor, I think you could tell the audience what some of the symptoms that you saw in yourself and in some of your comrades when you came home from war of post-traumatic stress.
Thank you. Yes, today is the exact anniversary of the withdrawal of Ukrainian forces from Debaltseve. As you know, it was heavy and deadly battle, one of the major battles in this war. we did not expect that we reservists will got into such trouble. It was heavy offensive from combined Russian and separatist forces. And of course, the consequences of this battle created lots of stress among our battalion, among more than 300 troops. And I can just name several signs, but I'm not a doctor to be sure that those signs are correct. But the most simple sign, it's night dreams about war, when during dream you continue to fight. Another strong sign of the PTSD is a feeling of guilt for your killed comrades. I personally had two of my close friends, officers, killed in action in Debaltseve. And I had, as an acting deputy commander, to call to their wives, now widows, to explain them how they died, how they were killed. And I had very tough, stressful talks with those widows, and I will never forget those talks. And PTSD sign is also the feeling of guilt. We survived, they were killed. Another problem for Ukrainian troops right now, that many men, they abandon, they decline the existence of PTSD. It's like a social norm in our society, when a man should be strong and will never have a tear, and they just reject that they have PTSD. But this is obvious for any psychiatrist or psychologist. I had several sessions with a psychiatrist personally, and she assured me that I have no PTSD. But actually I have some signs. And after those sessions, we made a list of 24 changes I had in personality after war. Not of them positive. One of the changes, like sharp reaction to injustice, inability to tolerate social injustice as before, and I have to deal with it, of course. And maybe I will continue later, but I would like to pause.
And one thing I'm curious about, though, is you came back from war and left the army. Mm-hmm. What were the resources available for you to seek help or seek treatment if you felt like you were having a problem?
No, of course, state medicine is not quick to help, and I will never had invited to state medical offices, to state psychiatrists, but we had volunteers, psychiatrists, they helped our battalion during our service and later after we were discharged. So I personally found my way, my personal psychiatrist, to talk to her, and thanks to volunteers for it. But many of our soldiers, as I know, we have contacts, and they just do not think that it's okay for them to ask for this help. Because another social norm, culture, it's if you will call to psychiatrists, this is like to show to everyone that you have a weakness. And it, for many men, it is not acceptable to show weakness. And that's sad, because they have problems, and those problems should be treated before they will grow to suicide or crime or something.
Right. Roman, one thing I know you and I have discussed before is the challenge of overcoming soldiers' reluctance to come forward and seek help. What are some ways you can overcome that, and how have you done that in your work?
So there are two programs in Ukraine ran by two organizations, Wounded War Ukraine and Pobratima.
There are two
There are two programs ran by two organizations, one the War Ukraine and Pobratim, and you can speak more what you guys do. The core idea is that the traditional medical model, even in the States, is that if you look at the process longitudinally, that there is an exposure to war-induced trauma, then there are symptoms, then people ignore the symptoms, the relationship with the family changes, and even when we ask US soldiers, we have given them an option, would you like to see a psychologist or psychotherapist or psychiatrist after coming back from combat, would you like to see them? Basically 99.9% say no, thank you. So even in US, it's not just in Ukraine, even in US and UK, there is a tremendous wall between the returning veterans and the medical community. And that results in the issues becoming more problematic and more chronic, and by the time the veteran may enter, for example, a psychologist's office or a medical system, it may be 10, 20 years after the actual initial shock trauma incident. And at that time, the treatment becomes much more challenging and much more expensive. So therefore, the approach that we are taking is that we are providing resources and abilities and training to returning veterans, first to assist them in overcoming their shock trauma, and then empowering them to work with other veterans, essentially simply by sharing their experience of how they overcame various post-traumatic stress syndromes. And we refer to this as post-traumatic stress syndromes, emphasizing again, similar to what you were mentioning, that it's not necessarily a disorder, they're just a clear set of symptoms, and it's not a big deal, you can work with these things.
Ivona, how have you addressed that issue? How do you overcome that reluctance to seek help with your work?
Well, as Roman mentioned, we both organizations use the system of peer-to-peer when a soldier shares his personal experience with his comrades, his brothers in arms, after returning from combat. In our case, we've created another system that is based on the peer-to-peer approach, but at the same time, we create a strong program for 1 month and a half. It's 45 days for 60 soldiers that will address their need of transformation after war. What I've noticed among veterans we've been working with, that a lot of them want to change their life after war. And actually, it's a great chance to do that. After a person has been away for a year or more from home, he's experienced a different life, he's experienced some very strong things in his life, and he's changed innerly, outerly, and he can actually express something new in his life. And they have a great potential because you will never find a better employee than a veteran who's overcome his trauma. You will never find a stronger person than a veteran who's overcome his trauma, because people who face their problems and who face their inner self and the changes in himself, they become only stronger. I understand the fear of some veterans of facing their problems, but what I can see from groups that we've been working with, these men are one of the strongest I met in my life. And so the program we are creating is basically the transformation program for those who are ready to face it and to go forward. We give them enough education, it's basically project management, business budgeting, we give them knowledges in English, in how to write a CV, how to transform your military experience into civil life. We give them knowledge about how to build a business and enterprise in Ukraine, how to seek for work, how to seek for partners, sponsors, whatever you need to create your own personal project further or to become a good employee. Also, we give them a strong psychological help during the project. We work with their family, we work with their children. Six times per the project, the family will be included in the project and they will fully undergo a training together with their men. As well, we give them a social network. So we create a network of 60 veterans who are bond with entrepreneurs from all over Ukraine who are ready to employ them and who are ready to work with them in their teams afterwards. This is one of the most important things for returning veteran as we see it. It's the priority of employment, of self-realization, the priority of housing. This is juridical help, law help, to find this help from the government, because our government has to provide housing for its veterans. And it's the benefits that you can get, because actually, if you transform your military experience, you can get a lot of benefits out of it. It will be a very hard work. It will take a lot of time. And it takes a lot of time not only for veterans, but for people who were involved in war. These are civilians, these are volunteers, these are all the people who had some connection with war. It will take time to overcome it. But once you do it, you become a lot better. You can grow out of it. And it will be one of the best experiences you had in your life that you transformed. Thank you.
Now, Viktor, when you came home and you realized you were starting to have some problems, so you're feeling those changes in your personality, did you feel like you could talk to, could you feel like if you talked to your family or your friends who had never been to war, that they would understand in any way the things you were feeling? Or is that an experience that only another veteran could understand?
Good question, and Nolan, thanks. My family accepted me as I am. They understood what I feel after war. But my civil friends, not from my battalion, they began to keep distance from me because they do not know how to treat me, how to talk to me, because they heard that he probably ill, but it's not right. We are not broken, it just changed. And in civil society, among my friends, civil friends, not everyone understands those changes and how to accept them. So this is true that many veterans, it is much more easy to talk among your inner circle of the battalion. So that's why my comrades, they often call to me, even in the late evening, just to talk, just to have friendly talk about life, not about our memories, but just to have a friendly talk, and they are getting a bit of relieving of the stress. And as I know, many of my comrades, they have the same issue, that society is trying to keep a distance from us, from those who fought. And I see this issue should be something fixed, to be fixed in some way.
And so, sort of piggybacking on that, we'll start with Ivona, but could you explain how you use veterans in your treatment program? So you're not having psychologists sit there and having the veteran lay down and tell their problems, but you're actually using veterans as therapists in a way. And I know, Roman, you do the same thing. So maybe you guys can explain how you do that.
Yeah, for sure. We don't fully push away the psychologist. A psychologist is like a mentor and a very important part of the process. But when you have a veteran in your group who's undergone the training before, you can actually easily approach the other veterans. It takes less time to approach the veterans community when you have a person with relevant experience. There's this thing about veterans that they mostly trust people with the same experience that they have. It works not only with veterans. In all groups that you try to form, it works the same way. Peer-to-peer works best, and it takes less time to get the trust from other people. In our programs, we train trainers, to say so. So we take a group of people who will undergo the training, and afterwards they have a chance to work with their comrades, with their brothers in arms. So we give them the chance to give lectures, to go to second training as a co-trainer, or as further on a trainer of the group. And for example, in the project I was telling about before, the Sector E project, we are going to use them as the most important training officers, to say so. So these will be the people who give the experience to the soldiers. Of course, we are keeping psychologists and psychiatrists as part of the process, but mostly they will work with the trainers, not with the soldiers themselves. So basically, we're building a society that will further on be able to exist on the communication and the network built by veterans for veterans.
Ron?
Yes, I think what I would like to add is that essentially in this model, the veteran who undergoes the training is sort of a bridge between the veteran and psychotherapist. So for example, many of our veterans who graduated from the training go through individual psychotherapy. So the goal here is not by any means to replace professionals and replace psychotherapists. And I know that this room, there are many psychotherapists from psychological crisis services group who has, within the past 2 years, has done an amazing job basically providing psychotherapy services for free to Ukrainian community and supporting the country, veterans, civilians on the Maidan. And so their work is absolutely essential. What we are trying to do is to provide that bridge between the returning veteran and then open up the veteran to the understanding that his experience of the change after coming back from war is absolutely normal, and it's something that he's not alone at, and there are tools that he can use to deal with these symptoms. And as a result, essentially, as compared to the traditional medical model where it takes 10 or 20 years when the person actually enters the medical system, this the peer-to-peer model allows the veteran to enter, to get help much sooner. And therefore, the work doesn't have to be pharmaceutical, for example, and it's much easier and much less expensive. But there is also sort of a different side to that coin when we talk about post-traumatic stress syndromes or post-traumatic stress disorder. We tend to focus on the veteran by himself or by herself, sometimes forgetting that there is a greater society. And what oftentimes happens with the veteran is that veterans are part of the society before war, and all those injustices that Ukrainians have to live with or have been living with for many years, this is the same society that the veteran used to live in. But then there is experience of the war, of living on the edge between life and death, that for many veterans tends to make them very sensitive to indifference. And then basically, in a way, what happens is that there is one more or less homogeneous society, and then some people go through the war, they become very sensitive to the indifference, then they come back, then there is a separation between these two segments of the society, and then the society tells them, oh, so you have PTSD, we have to work on you somehow, sort of forgetting that the society itself at large, not everybody of course, has certain problems like indifference to injustices, right? So, and it's very important that the society itself has to realize that the problem is not just that veterans need instruments to work through their PTSD, but the members of the society need to understand that the injustices that are intrinsic to the fabric of the society, that we have to work with this, because we have guys who have gone through our training who are amputees now because they were veterans, because they were fighting in this war to protect this country, and the government is not recognizing the fact that they're veterans, and therefore they're not being paid any kind of pension. This is something that is completely unimaginable in US or UK. We have guys who still have friends who have been POWs for the past 18 months. So there is this whole layer of social problem with most of the weight, not of the veterans, but on the society and the need for the society to change.
I think piggybacking on that point, and we start with Viktor, and I know Ivona, you've talked about this a lot too, how important is it to veterans to know that their war is recognized as a real war? I mean, does the fact that it's called an anti-terrorist operation, does that make it feel like society doesn't really recognize the significance of what you've been through and the fact that you've been through tank battles and artillery barrages?
On official level, of course, state is trying to encourage us that we did a great job. But on the local level and on the civil level, like everyday life, it's not always you can meet someone who will recognize that you did a good job and you defended your country. For 6 last months since I was discharged, I met only 2 people who said thank you for serving. One was in a trolley bus controller, and the second was in a metro, also a person who controlled the exit and entrance. So this is like a sign that not everyone on a local level thinks that it is okay to say thank you to every soldier they see. So that's my point of view.
It's almost ironic because in America we have the opposite problem. Whereas as a veteran or a soldier, you walk around and everybody says thank you for your service. And after a while you feel a little embarrassed about it. But it seems like here it's almost the exact opposite. For Ivona, how important it is for the healing of veterans to know that their war is recognized by society as a real war?
We had a chance to visit Denmark and to know some veterans from Iraq, from Afghanistan, from the Balkans, last summer actually. And basically this is a country that's been to war in the past years a lot, and their veterans are from different parts of the country and they've served in different countries, not on their land. And for me it was natural that that society would not recognize these veterans. It's more a natural process. But there we've heard a very interesting thought that the main thing for them was not the fact that their state cares about them, not the fact that their state supports them with finances and everything. The main fact was that the state recognizes them as veterans and the society itself recognizes them. In Ukraine it's now the complete opposite. You can hear people tell that veterans didn't serve in the army. I've actually talked to some veterans of the older wars that Ukraine participated in, and they said things like, now it's not a war, it's an anti-terroristic operation. And basically, people who don't support what's happening in Ukraine now on a political level have the chance of saying, okay, it's just an anti-terroristic operation, it's not a war. But how cannot it be a war if we will have over 100,000 veterans, almost 200,000 veterans by the end of the year? It's tremendous numbers. We have a lot of numbers of injured guys who are coming back and who have to live in this society and prove themselves every day. So basically they return from war and the real war starts, the war against the society that doesn't want to accept them. The fact that nobody says thank you is a little part of it. Mostly people, instead of saying thank you or just keeping silence, will say opposite things like, you weren't to war, you haven't been to war, that is not a war, it's not a declared war. If the state recognizes its veterans, it won't leave a chance to other people to say something. Of course, legally, lately, they've been recognized as veterans. We were searching for this law and we found out that our veterans are equal to the veterans of the Second World War and the veterans of Afghanistan and local wars. It is a very big step towards recognizing our veterans, not only in Ukraine, but in the World Veterans Society, and we're heading there because veteran communities in the world are very powerful. Ukraine is not yet there, fully taking part, but we are heading there. And I think that it is a very important issue whether your society, the one you return to, recognizes what you've done and just either keeps silence or is thankful to you, or it doesn't. But now, I'm not a veteran. I'm not allowed to speak from the name of veterans, so this is my personal opinion as of a volunteer who works with veterans.
Okay. Now, I know both of you have used the work of other countries and they're dealing with their soldiers coming back from war in your work. Can you explain really quickly what lessons you've learned from the experience of soldiers from the United States or other countries who participated in the war in Iraq and Afghanistan? What lessons you learned from those wars to guide you in the programs that you set up?
I think one of the first lessons, I remember when I was just starting out, I ran that little experiment asking US soldiers, the question that I mentioned before, is that would you like to see a psychotherapist? So what I did mention is that then I also asked a second question, would you like to see a massage therapist? So the answer to the first question was, no, thank you, goodbye. The answer to the second question was, yeah, of course, why not? Hell yeah. And that goes, for me, I was thinking and trying to figure out like what is actually going on, because I didn't have any background. My background is mathematical epidemiology, so I'm not a psychotherapist. I was trying to figure out, so what is going on? And actually when I was trying to start trainings in Ukraine, initially I was thinking, okay, we have to bring trainings to Ukrainian psychotherapists. But then what I heard from Ukrainian psychotherapists that they invest huge chunk of time in trying to reach out to the soldiers. And so the, one of the questions here is that, are we coming from the perspective of, let's say I'm a psychotherapist or I'm a psychologist and I have a certain set of skills and I want to be useful and I want to bring my knowledge and my help to the veteran, or we become veteran-centric in forgetting what kind of expertise we actually have, considering the veteran as a human being who has undergone certain traumatic experiences that oftentimes help him to develop spiritually, and then ask a simple question, what is it that the veteran wants, not what we want to bring on onto him, right? And then when you actually start asking a veteran, many veterans just openly share what they actually want. That sort of the problem, even in US, is that not many people ask. Right, and that's why, so the model that we are basing our program on, that model was created in Denmark by D.T. Marcher, who is a head of Bodynamic, which is a type of body-oriented psychotherapy approach. And that's why the body-oriented is very important, because many veterans, due to the hardships at the front lines, which may oftentimes affect them on purely physical level, they might be much more aware of physical discomfort that they may experience, and therefore they're much more open, as many of us, to actually figuring out why the heck their body hurts. And then when we go through that and help them to feel better in their own bodies, that develops a certain level of trust. And then, you know, other things follow much more openly. So the system that we are running, it's sort of consists of many holistic pieces that not just look traditionally psychology, but also look at the body. And that is, I think, a very important thing, and maybe the psychotherapists who are in the room
might
comment.
And Ivona, what lessons from other wars have you used in your program?
First of all, we've learned that we've missed something in our army. For the first place, we've missed the psychological preparation for a war. Our soldiers weren't prepared for what was happening. We had motivation, we had patriotism, but we had no psychological preparation. And a lot of people didn't know what will they face in the future. They weren't warned about it. We had more or less some support during the combat times, but it was more volunteer, it was more by people like us now, even though we had no experience at the time, and we still lack experience now, actually. And now we're trying to cover the people who are returning just on the places they come back. But we are facing the same problem they faced in Denmark and in a lot of other countries, actually. When our soldiers come back, they stand in a row, and their combat comes out to them, and he says, "Okay, guys, so who of you needs help? Psychological. Yeah. Don't be shy, just come out, just talk to us. Talk out your problems in front of the whole battalion." How do you think how many people will come out? Obviously. But there is another approach. Even if in smaller groups, when you come out to them with a veteran and you say, "Okay, I've been there, I've come back, I'm facing the same problems as you, buddy, are, let's talk about it. Let me tell you what I was facing, and it will be less scary to come back home." We're doing it now with the Kulchitsky battalion. It was one of the battalions that left for combat in May 2014, and they have returned only now. And it is a very interesting thing for us, because we don't give individual courses to them, no. We form a team out of people who've served together, and it works damn well. It works really, really well, because they know each other. They have common experience, and they can further on go together. They are a family, actually. And these bonds are much stronger than the ones you can form in civil life. And the second thing we understood in our program is that you cannot just close a gap and forget about it. It won't take you a year to heal 250,000 veterans. It takes time. And one veteran may come back and back and back for as long as he needs. And he needs to know that people who take the responsibility for his psychological health, let's call it so, for his psychological state, are sustainable, that they will last, that in 15 years, if he needs help, he will call the same person and say, you know, I feel very bad. May I come back? And he will come back. We need to create long-term sustainable projects. And if you take the responsibility for such a strong work, you need to create a system where it will work for a long, long time. We cannot just make something that will last for 1-2 years. Combatants from Iraq and Afghanistan and Balkans and all the other conflicts, sometimes they face their problems 10, 15 years after, and it's okay. It's personal in each case, and it takes just the right time for you to come out and say, I need help, to yourself. Just face this problem and say, I'm the one who needs help right now, at this moment, and I need to know where to find it. And I need to know that these people are responsible and experienced in what they're doing. Now we're only learning. Unfortunately, we have to learn in the field. We had no preparation. We had nowhere to study from. But we are now creating something really new in Ukraine. And what I understood while talking to colleagues from all over the world, there is nowhere a really good system of rehabilitation. American colleagues, Danish colleagues, Israeli colleagues all ask us, what are you doing? Tell us, we are interested because this is something new and our programs don't work that well. They have fought, even though America gives a lot of money to rehabilitation, Denmark gives a lot of money to rehabilitation, all the countries give a lot of money to rehabilitation, but it doesn't work. And we are now in a unique situation of an ongoing war on its territory with a very diverse range of veterans who are coming back. They're from 18 till 70 years old or even older. And we can study this. We now can bring something to the world scientific society and not only concentrate our programs in Ukraine. And it is very interesting. That's why we're trying to launch all the different organizations to find out what they can bring to us, but also what can we give them.
And Ivona, I know in some of our conversations, you've talked about how PTSD doesn't just start after war is over. And you stress the importance of counseling soldiers and talking to them while they're still in combat to sort of address those issues at the very beginning of the process and not wait 10, 15 years down the line.
For sure. That's also something we're trying to approach now. We are going to the war zone itself just to inform soldiers what may happen when you return. Because PTSD is not something that will definitely happen to you. It's just some percents of people. It is not a disease. It's not a virus. It won't spread along all the battalion. No, it's very individual. But a person has to know how it starts, to beware and just to ask for help when it begins. PTSD as a disease, to call so, but it is a very bad saying, disorder, whatever, stress. It may occur 3-6 months after combat. So a person returns home, he faces all the social problems here, all the new forms in him, all the social acceptance and stuff, and only then it can develop. It won't develop right after combat, so he comes back and the psychiatrist says, oh, okay, guy, you have PTSD. No, don't believe him. He's lying, definitely. And you have to wait. You have to give the combatant the time. We should give information. We should inform what it is like, how to work with it in the beginning, how to notice it in your brother in arms. But we cannot treat PTSD when it's not yet there. If it develops, it's a hard mental issue. It takes time to overcome it. But not everybody will have it. And we just need to inform soldiers on how to prevent it. At the moment, everything I'm doing and all the organizations around us are doing is preventing PTSD in our country. We haven't yet faced, me personally, I haven't faced a single Ukrainian soldier with PTSD. It's just impossible at the moment. Further on, quite soon, we may face some of the people like that, but it won't happen tomorrow, hopefully.
Now, Viktor, when I was a pilot in the Air Force, every time I would fire a missile in combat where I would kill somebody, they would require me to talk to a chaplain when I got back to base. The chaplain is a military priest, somebody you, officer usually, but it's a priest. And they would also usually ask for me to speak to a psychologist. In the Ukrainian army, are there chaplains? I mean, are there any counseling services available to people on the front lines?
I cannot to talk about all army, but in our battalion, we had chaplains in Debaltseve, and I personally contacted and invited them to our troops just to talk and to celebrate Christmas and other celebrations. And so, and as I know, the system of chaplains in the Ukrainian army is developing. Many priests voluntarily agree to come to soldiers and live with them in trenches and to support them in their religious needs. But it's just the beginning of the system. We have problems with their legal status and discussions in the Ministry of Defense about how to treat them and their status inside the system. So, but I hope Parliament will change the legislation a bit just to make it easy for priests to help our army. But it's important. It's the priest is the same as a psychiatrist and a psychologist, and this is like treating souls, not only minds, but souls.
Right. I think we'll go down the line with this next question, but in America, throughout the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, we've actually lost more soldiers to suicide than we had in combat. More soldiers have killed themselves than have actually died in the wars. In addition to that, in America, divorces and substance abuse, so alcohol and drugs, are another big problem for soldiers who ignore their symptoms of PTSD. With all of your work, Viktor, your experience in the military, and then with your work with veterans, what are the negative consequences that you're seeing in Ukraine for people who do not seek help?
Well, of course, suicide is the worst mark you can get for returning, to say so. It is very hard to work with people who are facing suicide, especially with veterans, because they don't seek help. Mostly they just hide away. And it's hard to find these people because due to the system was a little broken in the army at the beginning with the documents and everything, it's even harder now to seek out and counsel the veterans after they come from combat. But it is not everybody again. Our statistic at the Ministry of Defense says about 171 person, and it's growing bigger every day, unfortunately, but it's official statistics. Yes, definitely there are more veterans and soldiers there on the front who have killed themselves. It is a hard topic. There are not so many professionals in Ukraine to work with combat suicides. And we, personally, I haven't faced that in my work lately. But as well, divorces, for example, stories about divorces during combat were one of the starting points for me to begin the program. Because, as I've told before, I was a volunteer at the front lines in 2014-2015, and about December 2014 happened a situation when I had to spend 6 days in Debaltseve without a car and under the snow, so we had to just talk to the soldiers on the front lines for 6 days straight. And mostly I heard one story from everybody, from a couple of soldiers at the same time. I've come back and on the railway station my wife has handed me divorce papers. Or my child called me and asked, okay, daddy, why is this guy in our house? What's happening? Where are you? And listening to all these stories, I understood that it'll be a big problem. And actually, a lot of veterans, as a statistic, when returning back home, all over the world, they lose their families, they get into divorces, but it's okay. We always talk about returning as a common problem among veterans, their families, close ones, veterans, volunteers, everybody who's been to the front lines and been connected to that. Because in a year that a veteran is away from home, his family changes a lot. The wife has to take more responsibility on herself, she has less support, maybe she has more problems accepting his choice, because if the veteran himself, he makes a choice to go there as a soldier, he packs his bag and he goes away, he could have signed papers for Poland and run away, as in Ukrainian case, but he went there to the front line. and she has to just accept this choice and take over all the responsibility over the house. And you know that in the American army there is this interesting, very, very interesting for me study that those pilots of drones who have only observed the field where the battle was, they got PTSD 80% higher than the participants of the same battle because they couldn't affect it. They were just observing. They could see the people dying, but they couldn't do anything to it. The same thing happens to wives. They see it on TV. They know their husband is somewhere out there. He's not telling them. He's like, oh yeah, I'm okay. I'm in the sauna. You know, I just had a bath. Of course. But she sees that every day on TV, two people have died, four people were injured. During the Debaltseve, it was way more, and it was horrible to see it all on the TV. And she cannot do anything to that. So when a soldier comes back, he's different, but his family is also different. His children grown, his wife has developed new skills, as for a woman, became a lot stronger, and they face each other. And sometimes it's a solution to break up. We always try to tell veterans that you need to give yourself time. Don't make any critical decisions in the first half a year after combat. Don't break your family, don't go away. Stay, just give yourself some time, because everything may change. You're in stress, you've come back from hell, but it can change. If not, sometimes it's a decision to start a new life. It's okay, it's not killing for some people, but if he gets assistance. Again, the surrounding is one of the most, plays a vital role in the rehabilitation of a soldier. He himself, he won't do it. Some of them try to run away to the woods, some of them try to isolate themselves from society, but mostly further on, when they decide to come back, they still need the assistance of the surrounding, and they need to build up a comfortable community around them to fit in again.
I think Ivona covered it very well. I think the element that I would like to add is that what we are just have been talking about leads to the question of how we as a society deal with it, because it's great to have two, you know, projects running in Ukraine. It's a good beginning, but there are certain things which are also clearly dysfunctional on the level of government. So on one hand, after Maidan, there has been an uprising in volunteer efforts, including in the psychological assistance. On the other level, sort of certain elements within the government are still sort of broken, and as an example, there has been certain funding given for psychological rehab, and we know that some districts has gotten this funding for 2015 on December 15th. So they had 15 days to actually allocate that assistance to the veterans. And in many cases, the veterans were offered a two-week journey to sort of rehab facilities.
Sanatory.
You know, where the volunteer psychologists would try the best to do the best they could, oftentimes under the circumstances. But this is not a good thought out system of rehab. And it's amazing, because I mean, on one hand, this is just unthinkable in US, even we have a lot of other problems and pretty substantial ones. But I mean, how does this happen when the volunteer organizations are scrambling for money to run, you know, psychological crisis service group, the Pobratimy, Wounded Warrior, other organizations are scrambling for funds to run the trainings, and then there are 50 million grivnas allocated for psychological rehab, and they just go into the air. So,
more?
50 million, I suppose, officially.
So, what we started, in our case, we also started as a program focused purely on psychological rehabilitation, but then you start facing these issues, like the issue of POW, which is a hugely challenging issue, because each family tries to free up
their loved one, and then when he is freed, in terms of society, that member of the family is no longer interested, actively interested in freeing and working on freeing other POWs. And therefore, from perspective of sociological perspective, you have sort of a reducing or whatever changing pool of people who are interested in certain issue, which makes it very challenging to defend the rights of these people, right? Then the how does this happen that, you know, we really need to build to think system-wise and to think how do we foresee to work with all the shock trauma that happened to veterans and to the civilians, and how do we build that system? So now we're trying to just make first steps in this by initiating collaboration with reanimation package of reforms together with people from psychological crisis service group, trying to think like how do we build that system. And that's hugely important because I think that while our projects are great, there needs to be a well thought out government strategy on how to work with this.
Okay. Can I add on that, please?
Yeah, go ahead.
About the government support and everything. We had some talks to the government in the past year. We actually were making some real attempt towards communicating with the government and actually wanted our program of Sector E to be governmental from the Ministry of Internal Affairs. But we faced the fact that now the Ministry of Internal Affairs, instead of actually valuing the volunteer movement that is going on in Ukraine and the factual experiment that we can make in this field and discover new methods of working with veterans, they bring some stops for us. They want to make a single system of rehabilitation for the whole country. Instead of creating centers that would coordinate and give money to volunteer organizations that are doing pretty well, and as to my opinion and as to experience of our partners, for example, in the same Denmark, they've created a system of veteran support centers, governmental, that provide psychological assistance by veterans who've been to combat but who got psychological education. So they're very well-educated psychologists with military experience. And you can receive this treatment for free. There is a hotline working all day long. You can call them. But at the same time, the main task of this center is to coordinate volunteer movements in the region. So basically, they receive a call from a veteran and then spread it to this, the volunteer movements. And they also give the money from the government to the volunteer movements all over the country. And that is, as to my opinion, the solution in the Ukrainian case, when we have a lot of very qualified, good volunteer movements that just need the funding from the government and can actually cover the question. So,
I think before we hand it over to the audience for some questions, I'll put you guys on the spot with one final question. Should be a pretty easy one, but what's one myth or misperception about post-traumatic stress that you'd like to see corrected? Start with Viktor and come on down the line.
First of all, I would like society to be open to accept veterans back to society, not to distance from us, not to keep a distance. Try to understand, and it will be beneficial for veterans and for the society. Because as Ivona said previously, we changed, and those changes can help all the society to get better, especially veterans are very good employees.
Probably one of the myths I want to ruin, and this is one of the most important things in our work, is that veterans who face even PTSD or other stress reactions, acute stress reactions, are weak. No, they're very, very strong people, and this strength is frightening. I know that. I work with them. But it is magnificent to look at. And the vital role in this change may play the media, because we've overcome the time of poor, needy soldiers on the front line that we faced in 2014. I'm sorry for such words, but this is how the media showed it. The soldiers who had no shoes, the soldiers who had no uniforms, it's true. I was delivering that stuff to the front lines. I know that it's true. But it's not like that anymore. We are now welcoming back very strong men who have a great experience, and we have to look at them as very strongest people, and to show them that way. We have to show that it is the biggest strength for a returning soldier to face his problems and to show to the society that he is ready to work with it. Not because he's bad, no, he's a great person, but because his experience was so hard that he has to take his time to overcome it and overthink it. Then we may change this question. Otherwise, we will be still looking at soldiers who don't want to go to the psychologist because they're basically afraid of becoming weak.
I think I'm going to respond to a question with a question. I'm not a veteran, but you are. I think your opinion matters much more, and you can share much more than I can. You're
on
the spot.
Yeah. No, I think just piggybacking on what both Viktor and Ivona said, that, you know, soldiers shouldn't be pitied when they come back. I think that's one thing in America that sort of was off-putting. It made you feel a little awkward when you came home. Everybody looked at you like there was something wrong with you, like you're going to snap. You know, or they looked at you like you were just really sad, yet the war had somehow ruined your mind. But, you know, what you said, Viktor, is true, is that veterans make really good employees. A lot of times the lessons you learn in your military service or in combat are lessons that you could never have learned in civilian life. And it makes you better at a lot of things, and it also gives you problems to deal with as well. But I think, yeah, the biggest misperception, I think, is that combat veterans are somehow damaged by their experiences. In my opinion, I think most combat veterans are actually stronger people when they come home. They've learned a lot of lessons that they could have never otherwise learned. And I'm a Hemingway nut as a writer, I have to admit. And one of his best quotes is that we're often stronger in the broken places. And it's very true. You come back from war and you have wounds in your mind and in your soul, but over time you become stronger because of that. And war can actually, and it's a great contradiction among a lot of veterans, is that you ask them, what's the worst experience of your life? And they'll say it was war. And then you ask them, well, what's the best experience of your life? And they'll usually say it was war too. I never felt so alive, I never felt so much love for my fellow soldiers. And that's really hard for somebody to understand who's never been to war, because you see the death and destruction and the terrible parts of it, but you also don't see, and I hate to say this, but the beautiful parts of it as well. And I think that's one thing that I think is very hard to explain to civilians, but it's a really important lesson to try and to teach them to understand the soldiers when they come back. So with that, would love to get some questions from the audience, so fire away. I think we'll have a microphone.
Тут така справа. Я з розмови зрозумів, що багато хто з вас не розуміє основної суті тих, які зараз в армії. Я зараз пресофіцер одного підрозділу, а до того часу я працював, ну, служив у військкоматі. І я знаю, які люди пішли в армію. Ці люди, які прийшли в армію з великим букетом психологічних проблем. Друге, наше суспільство створило такий імідж, що вони, ці люди, які зараз в армії воюють, вони по телевізору бачать, що їх зустрінуть з фанфарами, з трояндами. Тобто вони вже себе бачать в майбутньому як героїв, які в бюджеті краще, ліпше, ніж в тому житті довоєнному. Якщо ми далі будемо продовжувати цей такий імідж героїв, за яким вони будуть жити краще, а цього не станеться, звичайно. В них якраз виходить та ломка. І це дуже важлива така причина, яку, в принципі, нехтують. Знаючи по тому, як проходить мобілізація, по мобілізації проходять люди неуспішні в суспільстві. І алкоголіки, і низові люди. Ці люди, які потрібні зараз в армії, вони уникають мобілізації, і вони ж не підуть по контракту. По контракту, знову ж, підуть неуспішні люди, тому що там в армії обіцяють великі гроші. Звичайно, успішні люди не підуть в армію, бо вони заробляють ці гроші тут, в цивільному житті. І мені здається, що перша причина того синдрому, який ми обговорюємо, є в тому, що в армії служать неуспішні люди.
Дозвольте, я дам свою думку з цього приводу. Ми знаємо, що більшість проблем починається до війни. І людина зазнає дуже багатьох травм ще до того, як вона потрапила на війну. І те, що людина обирає шлях війни, вже є досить гарним показником цього. Але ми говоримо про те, що це війна – це шанс для цієї людини вирости над собою. Для деяких це той переламний період, який дозволить їм в подальшому досягнути більшого. Не через те, що він герой, не через те, як суспільство перші 5 хвилин по його приїзду обкидає його трояндами, а потім відпустить додому. Зовсім не через це. Але якщо ця людина зрозуміє, що, можливо, завищені очікування, можливо, не зовсім те сталося, чого він очікував, але буде готовий над цим працювати, мені здається, що в такому разі він зможе набагато вирости над собою.
Можна продовжити? Справа в тому, що людина, яка була вирвана військкоматом з якогось села, де закриваються бібліотеки, де приїжджають артисти, де не бувають всілякі виставки і так далі, там життя нема. Там просте таке виживання. І та людина з тим, скажімо там, синдромом героя, я його так назву, приїжджає в те саме село, там нічого не змінилося. Він там як не був потрібний в тому селі, так і лишився нікому не потрібним. Причому в нього там ордена, можливо, там місцеві влади його там пару раз згадають, але в ньому, в його житті нічого не зміниться. І тут мені здається, що якщо боротися з тим поствоєнним синдромом, то треба заглядати більше в корінь. Що людина, вона має свої власні проблеми.
Ми розуміємо. І саме до того ми прописуємо, наприклад, нашу програму таким чином, щоб дати цій людині інструмент до змін. Тому що коли він приїде і побачить, що нічого не змінилося, перша думка, яка в нього виникне, як у людини, яка діяла рік або півтора напряму, буде «я хочу тут щось змінити». Але дуже багато в кого немає цього інструменту. У нас є великі сподівання в суспільстві, що зараз прийдуть воєнні і все, значить, змінять одразу. Просто автоматом воєнні вернуться і в нас все зміниться. Цього не станеться, тому що багатьох воєнних в першу чергу немає інструменту до цих змін. Ми надаємо цей інструмент, ми надаємо розуміння того, наприклад, в тій програмі, яку розробляємо ми з колегами, як працювати з цим, що зробити особистісно, як розвинути проєкт, як його втілити, навіть в селі, де немає бібліотеки. Де шукати на нього кошти? Як виходити в світ уже з тим, що ти вигадав, що ти хочеш зробити? Це наш підхід до цього. Ми не можемо покрити всіх, ми не врятуємо всіх військових, це неможливо. Просто. Не треба ставити собі завищених завдань. Але ми, допомагаючи тим, кому ми допомагаємо, робимо вже багато. І зробимо ще більше, якщо ці люди матимуть інструмент до роботи зі своїми побратимами.
So I should say that my Ukrainian is like really, really bad because I was born in Moscow, and that's my excuse. But from what I understood, what you said contains certain generalizations that I personally disagree with, and I think the veterans that are in the room, if they would like to, they may respond much better than I am.
The poltergeist.
Ми приймали питання в різні.
Доброго дня, шановні колеги. Доброго дня, шановні співробітники посольства. Дякуємо за запрошення. Представлюсь, хто мене не знає, військовий психолог Світлана Літвінчук, керівник одного з центрів підготовки та реабілітації військових. Хочу кілька моментів сказати і на відповідь військового і, власне, з того, що я почула, дати зворотній зв'язок. З приводу популяризації, з приводу інформування, абсолютно ви вірно зазначили, тому що війна, вона не закінчується, коли наш солдат демобілізується. Вона для нього продовжується ще далі, поки він адаптується в суспільстві, поки його сім'я адаптується, приймає його. Ну, ми всі, хто професійні психологи, це розуміє. Потрібно ще дуже важливо донести то суспільству і донести те, що є психологи, які допомагають в цих питаннях. З приводу інформування я запускаю інформаційний ресурс, в якому навіть водій маршрутки зможе розібратися з приводу того, де є по Україні психологи і які є. Колеги, будь ласка, хто тут є, буду рада співпрацювати. Це з приводу інформування, такий зворотній зв'язок. З приводу відповіді військовому, який зазначав тільки що певні факти. Дійсно, я хочу з вами погодитися. Є моменти такі, непрості в нашій державі, і це реальність, від цього нікуди ми не дінемося. Але я вважаю, що найостаннє, що потрібно робити, це казати військовому, що ми нічого не змінимо, нічого не зміниться. І з приводу того, що ви сказали, що йдуть самі такі, ну, незатребувані люди в нашій державі, зазвичай з великими проблемами, в батальйони, в військові підрозділи. Вибачте, але я з вами не погоджуюсь, і як не погодяться і багато присутніх тут. В мене є безліч прикладів, коли люди змінювали свою долю. З моєї практики, я не буду про практику інших своїх колег казати, з моєї практики. Це коли бізнесмени залишали свій бізнес і їхали на фронт звичайними співробітниками. Один із них – Ендрю. Вся країна знає, це людина з мого міста, Ендрю. Це чудова людина. Він свій бізнес залишив, він робив те, що він робив. Я особисто залишила, коли після блокади Криму я залишила свою приватну діяльність. Я пішла на безоплатну роботу військовим психологом. Ніхто, держава мені не платила. Я свої кошти вкладала в те, щоб їздити і допомагати хлопцям. На тому все. Це відповідь з приводу вашого закиду, що там, ну, лише такі якісь непотрібні абсолютно в суспільство люди йдуть, або проблемні люди. Дійсно, є такий момент, що дуже часто хлопці, які там опиняються, вже зараз і дівчата, це люди, які тікають від своїх соціальних якихось негаразд і проблем. Але, вибачте, хочу сказати, як психолог, який консультує також індивідуально, що дуже багато в суспільстві, в інших професіях також таких випадків. Коли люди тікають в роботу замість того, щоб вирішувати свої проблеми. Це реальність. Це реальність буття будь-якої людини. Тому було б, ну, дуже несправедливо по відношенню до наших захисників говорити таким чином. Просто це я вам кажу. Ви можете зі мною не погодитись, це ваше право. Дозвольте, я завершу. Якщо вам буде що сказати, ви мені скажете. І наостанок, вибачте, якщо якось своєю промовою втомила, але просто наболіло. Поставтесь, будь ласка, з розумінням. І наостанок. Кожен з нас...
I don't mean to interrupt, but I know there's other people with questions as well, so it's...
Sorry, да. Будь ласка. Найпростіше, що ми можемо зробити, це сказати будь-якому військовому, в тебе все вийде, і я в тебе вірю. Все. Дякую.
My name is Vadim Kaminsky. I'm also volunteer of AERO recognition, perhaps, or intelligence. So, I just put on light for everybody. You are absolutely convincing, and I'd like to extend our party. That's it. What our further steps to communicate, to do something with it?
I actually know Maria Berlinska very good. I understand you're from the same team, right? And we already communicated on the rehabilitation of women soldiers, and her project is very, all of her projects are very inspiring for me personally.
There's a lady back there. Or did
I
you
just
want
to say goodbye?
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Unfortunately, I have to say goodbye. I have to catch a train. In 25 minutes, so I'm going to lie. I apologize to leave earlier, but it was a great pleasure, and I'm sorry that I missed the discussion, which is the most interesting part in Ukrainian discussions. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Спасибо вам большое, во-первых, за программу, которую вы привезли. Спасибо за сегодняшнюю конференцию. У меня два вопроса маленьких. Во-первых, есть ли какие-то гендерные различия? То есть к вам приходили девушки, которые прошли войну, и какие это именно гендерные различия? Это первый вопрос. И второй вопрос, какой процент людей после вашей программы хочет работать на фронте? Хочет работать дальше?
как психолог?
Дякую за питання. Це дуже цікаве питання. Я з кінця відповім про психологію. У нас є декілька випадків, коли військові залишаються на службі в армії і надалі передають ті знання, які вони отримали своїм побратимам. Це досить невеликий відсоток людей насправді, але вони є, і це круто. Тому що нашій країні потрібні професійні кадрові військові, які будуть продовжувати навчати наступні мобілізації, наступних строковиків, тому що дай Боже, зі скоро закінчиться, і мобілізувати вже буде не потрібно нікого. Але дуже важливо розуміти, що люди, які навіть були бізнесменами, яких своє там минуле, як і у всіх у нас своє минуле до цих 3 років, які сталися нам останнім часом, це класно, що вони знайшли себе на війні. Але це треба усвідомлювати, що мені це в кайф. Я хочу цим займатися. І це моє покликання. Це дуже добре, якщо людина це усвідомлює і готова повернутися до цього після певного часу в цивільному житті. Не одразу, тому що немає іншого виходу, а як усвідомлене рішення. Про гендерну різницю. У нас є зараз учасники серед жінок. І для мене особисто дуже цікаво спостерігати за цією комунікацією, тому що як такої гендерної нерівності торкаються багато зараз людей, зокрема, Марія Бернінська, яку тільки що згадували. У нас в групі гендерної різниці, як такої, ми не помітили, насправді. На фронті є різні думки, це залежить від кожного особистого випадку, але ПТСР і взагалі будь-які проблеми після війни, вони не мають статі, раси, вони не мають різниці в конфлікті, в якому ми брали участь. Війна впливає на всіх однаково. І може бути тільки індивідуальна різниця, незалежно від статі людини.
Дякую. Мене звуть Євген Білоножко, я волонтер. Я стартував як волонтер 19 лютого 2 роки тому і з того часу продовжую. Я професійний психолог. До речі, я дуже дякую за запрошення. Така зустріч дуже потрібна. І я зараз задам питання. І питання буде в тому, чому вам потрібна допомога. Скажу про що саме. А перед цим я скажу от до цього поважного чоловіка, що сказав про цю проблему, що йдуть люди дуже неадаптовані. І там є можливість їм мати сенс життя. Я хочу вас підтримати повністю, 100%. Бо коли Майдан розганяли, величезна частина майданівців, що тоді були, ще влітку, справді, це був для них єдиний вихід, продовжити свою справу і мати сенс у життя. Вони були змушені туди піти, і вони пішли добровільцями, і це не є чимось негативним. Що я хочу сказати, це нормально. Ці люди там справді знаходяться на життя, а тим, кому важко, ми маємо допомогти. Я з тих, хто чекає наших бійців, щоб вони сюди прийшли і змінили цю країну. Це так має бути. Це так було задумано і так буде, якщо ми їх тут зможемо зустріти. Для цього нам треба об'єднатися. І тому моє питання до вас. Ви сказали про ці 50 мільйонів. Це дуже важлива річ. Держава нам цих грошей нікому не дала. Це схема. У чому вам потрібна допомога, якщо ви цим зайнялися, щоб все ж таки розібратися з цією державою у цьому питанні? Хай ми ці гроші не отримаємо, але хай це стане відомим фактом для громадського суспільства, щоб ми все ж таки могли на них натиснути. Ми, наша невеличка, може, група, готова доєднатися до цих зусиль, щоб здійснити тиск на тих, хто нам показав ці 50 мільйонів і кудись їх заховав. Дякую за увагу.
Дякую вам. Як я вже казала раніше, наша співпраця з державою поки що залишається на консультаційному рівні. Ми робили деякі спроби до співпраці активної з державою, пропонували свою програму для імплементації саме державними органами, на початку, як я вже зазначала, це Міністерство внутрішніх справ. На жаль, ми не готові поки що покласти власні імена на вінець розвитку нової України в тому плані, в якому це бачить наша держава. І ми готові допомагати державі розібратися в питанні і скоординувати волонтерів, але ми зараз не будемо вступати в війну за примарні кошти, які для нас особисто не грає такої зараз великої ролі. Наші програми вартісні, тому що ми виховуємо професіоналів в країні. Ми вкладаємо знання і освіту в тих, професіоналів, яких раніше в Україні не було. Це вперше. Це феноменальна річ, коли реабілітаційні програми виникають саме з таких рухів, як у нас зараз. І ми можемо дуже багато привнести. Але якщо ми зараз почнемо працювати з державою, то ми не зробимо абсолютно нічого. Тому що ті методи розподілення коштів, які наразі існують в нашій державі, вони не дають волі до руху. А тут зараз треба бути мобільним. Зараз треба пробувати динамічні програми. Не гору бюрократичних різних машин проходити, а діяти. Діяти в експерименті, діяти в новому руслі, пробувати. Як краще дізнаватися у військових, що їм йде, що їм не йде, які результати дає програма. В бюрократичній машині ми поки що цього не зможемо зробити.
Можна тут ремарку маленьку? Понимаете, у нас еще в чем парадокс? У нас на самом деле в стране законодательно не прописан вообще психотерапевт. У нас нет этой специальности. Понимаете, реабилитолога у нас тоже нет. Деньги выделены, эти 52 миллиона гривен выделены, когда там в четырех санаториях ставка психолога одна или две. Ну, это нонсенс, понимаете? То есть люди, которые работают психотерапевтами, работают сейчас незаконно. Вы осознаете вообще весь масштаб того, что происходит? Люди-волонтеры, которые являются там психотерапевтами европейского, там, с европейскими дипломами, они не имеют права работать на этой земле. Мы работаем на свой страх и риск. Вот все, что нужно знать об этой стране. По поводу психотерапии.
Ну, але все ж таки ми чомусь з неї два роки виїмо, так що я думаю, що все нормально, це переживеться.
Ми любимо, так. Ми любимо, так.
Hello, thank you very much for the talk, very needed, I think. And my question is about the ways how you deal with people who are experiencing PTSD. I've been to a few conflict zones, and I know that people who experience conflicts, when they share their experience, when they tell their stories, it helps them to heal their wounds. Do you practice that when dealing with PTSD, and how effective is when they, veterans just get together and share the war that they experienced, just tell again whatever they went through?
Thank you for the question. Actually, as I told you, the building a community of veterans, a strong community where veterans know how to assist each other in their problems, in their flashbacks, in whatever comes back from war, is very important. That's why we build groups, small groups of 20-25 people maximum, to give them the instruments how to work with each other, except of vodka and, okay, let's talk about it, buddy. Of course, it helps, but it won't bring results in strategical plan. So basically, we teach them not only how to talk to each other, how to understand your personal wounds and work them through, but how to work with your comrade, brother in arm, even if he is not from the group. But you're right that creating a strong community, small community of veterans, when every veteran knows that he can call 2-3 people and they will listen and they will know what to say to him and how to take him out of the situation. It is very, very important. It's probably the most important thing that we can do at the moment. Because psychological assistance to one veteran who is away from his brothers in arms because he lives in a village, as you stated, or he is just in bad contact with all of his comrades, no matter what the problem is, it won't help as much as if he can lean on somebody. You know, in a strong community behind him and know that here there is this band of guys standing behind him and they won't let him go. That is very important.
I think just piggybacking on what Ivona said, as somebody who's been to war both in the military and as a journalist, I have to say that coming back as a journalist is much more difficult. Because as a soldier, you come back with your unit. You come back with your brothers. And you come back home and you get to hang out, you play sports, you go to the bars together. You have that community with you to help kind of ease back into normal life. As a journalist, you know, you just take the train back and you go have dinner by yourself at Posada Hada. And you see, and you're sitting there eating by yourself and it's just like, man, and you feel like your mind's spinning because a couple hours before, you know, you're getting shot at by a tank. And so I think, yeah, the camaraderie in that community is so important. Because that's the thing that I think you feel the loss of the most when you leave the military, is the loss of that camaraderie, that brotherhood with your fellow soldiers. I think we have time for probably one more, unless you want to add something.
I can add something, a little thing here. And actually, phenomenally in Ukraine, this volunteer movement that arose now, and volunteers who are running 2 years in a row, if veterans had vacations, we hadn't. Like, we are those strange people who don't have vacations, weekends, or whatever normal people have. And we don't have a community, actually. We are all, like, one by one, working hard, but we don't have who to lean on. And that's why we are now starting and trying to start training for volunteers, to create this little community of volunteers who've been working for 2 years in a row and now need to support each other, and for journalists as well. We want to start this year a training for journalists who will be helping out each other, so like people like Nolan, who experience these amazing things on the front lines, can call another journalist and say, okay buddy, I just need to talk now, because when you go there as a volunteer or as a journalist, you're responsible for your personal life. In the military, you can lean on your brothers in arms. As a volunteer, you lean on yourself and the people in your car. And it's much more responsibility, and we feel lonely, to tell the truth.
Yeah. So I think
more
we have time
question?
For... Well, people can stay as late as they want, but... I may start over there, and then we'll come to you next.
Добрий вечір. Марія Назарова, інструктор статичної медицини. Працюю з армією, поліцією, силовими структурами. Моє питання полягає в тому, Івона починала говорити про те, що ми готуємо ветеранів, вони повертаються до суспільства, і суспільство не готове прийняти їх, навіть підготовленими. Чи є в нас якісь інструменти роботи з суспільством для розуміння того, що таке війна, що таке ветерани війни, і як їм, цивільним, сприймати їх? Тому що в деяких моментах військові більш нормальні, ніж цивільні, і ми всі це розуміємо. І коли вони повертаються, навіть підготовленими, навіть пройшовши певну реабілітацію психологічну і соціальну, вони стикаються з абсолютним нерозумінням. Чи можуть це бути якісь шкільні програми? Це може це, ну, це набагато більше об'єм роботи, да, аніж просто військові. Чи є якісь такі інструменти роботи? Дякую наперед за відповідь.
Ну, про школи це взагалі дуже цікаво. Я думаю, ми всі бачили малюнки дітей, і мені здається, вони набагато краще розуміють за нас, що відбувається в країні, і набагато легше це сприймають, ніж ми. Але при цьому, насправді, це те, про що я говорила, про те, що медіа насправді в цьому ключі відіграє найбільш значущу роль. Якщо вони зуміють показати ветеранів такими, якими вони є насправді, а не під призмою того, що цим людям потрібна допомога, просто чисту картинку, без інтерпретацій, це може зіграти найбільш значущу роль в цьому питанні. Так, то мені колеги нашіптують, що мені говорити. Насправді ми проводимо тренінги для не тільки для тих людей, які напряму контактували з війною, а, до прикладу, до соціальних працівників, для працівників ЖЕКів, які стикаються з військовими в своєму повсякденному житті. Це і люди, в чиї колективи повернулися ветерани, вони дзвонять нам, кажуть, у нас тут колектив 20 людей, у нас 6 з них ветерани. Як з ним нам працювати? Ну 6 – це ж хороша така банда, я вам хочу сказати, ветеранів в компанії. І це дуже важливо, це інформація про психологічну едукацію, її зараз так називають, для суспільства, про те, що таке повернення від війни, тому що нас не тільки ветеранам, їх сім'ям, волонтерам, і тим, хто безпосередньо брав цьому участь, оговтуватись від цієї ситуації. Той інформаційний простір, в якому ми існуємо вже ось 2 роки, він вплинув абсолютно на всіх в цій країні. І навіть якщо ви ніколи не бачили ветерана вживу, то це не означає, що на вас не вплинулася війна. Нам ще дуже довго всім пропрацьовувати власні питання, і може так статися, що якщо ми не пропрацюємо цього, то це пропрацьовувати нам ще нашим дітям. І тому я тут абсолютно підтримую Машу в тому, що нам потрібно йти до суспільства, до максимальної кількості людей з цим питанням. Дякую.
There's a young lady back there who had been waiting for a question.
Просто пані Марія зняла з язика моє питання, але я хотіла трошечки, можливо, його уточнити. Я працюю із адмінапаратом Донецької області, проукраїнської Донеччини, і ми стикаємося дуже часто з такими ситуаціями, коли повертаються військові, і в нас, наприклад, вони або отримують статус УБД, або просто йдуть, як ви згадали, наприклад, в ЖЕК чи ще кудись. І там сидить така собі стереотипна бабуся, яка починає просто кричати на цього військового. І звісно, що ці люди, вони можуть не дивитися телевізор, тобто питання з медіа в нас, в принципі, десь допоможе, якщо ми змінимо образ. Десь, можливо, на жаль, і ні, тому що не у всіх є можливість. А також вони не звертаються здебільшого до окремих організацій, вони не їздять на тренінги, тому що елементарно немає транспортної можливості. І, власне, зараз ми працюємо над тим, щоб якось це зробити більш силовим, дозвольте так сказати, чином підготувати цих людей. Абсолютно вірно Маша сказала, щоб суспільство було готове зустріти цих ветеранів, тому що дійсно вони більш підготовлені. А до яких організацій, можливо, ви мені підкажете, можна звернутися?
Можуть бути секунди, дні, роки і її сприйняття, і інтерпретація цієї події. І, власне, якщо подивитися, що в нас відбувається сьогодні в залі, ми намагаємося інтерпретувати ті події для того, щоб пояснити, що відбувається з нами, що відбувається з суспільством, і ми починаємо з себе. Я завжди казала, волонтери – це ті люди, які допомагають в першу чергу самим собі. Тому що вони займають активну позицію стосовно тої ситуації, яку змінити неможливо, і треба якимось чином щось робити. Тому ми з вами працюємо, робимо, і кожен в цьому залі мав рацію стосовно того, що він казав. Це така ремарочка, дякую за увагу.
One more.
Last question.
Is it a question?
Дякую за запрошення. Дуже цікаво було послухати те, що говорили доповідачі. У мене є таке доповнення. Я також інструктор по естетичної медицини. Я практично вже другий рік катаюся по зоні, в тилу працюю. Нюанс в чому заключається? У нас немає, ну, скажімо так, це моя персональна думка, але все-таки у нас немає мирної частини країни. У нас немає суто військової частини країни, там, де точиться війна. У нас вся країна знаходиться в стані війни. Якщо ми розділяємо якось собі ментально, що ось є мирні люди, які не розуміють військових, і ось є військові, які не можуть зрозуміти, чому тут народ ходить в кабак і так далі, і так далі, ми створюємо проблему розділення суспільства. У нас є єдиний організм суспільства, який на даний момент лихоманить. Його лихоманить від п'яти до вух, і з цим нічого неможливо зробити, крім того, щоб вилікувати його, допомігши цілому суспільству, а не конкретно там руці, нозі, там солдату, чи волонтеру, чи журналісту, пройти через цей катарсис. Суспільство має очиститися, пройти своєрідну імунізацію, і самим процесом цієї імунізації є війна. Найближчі років 30-40 нам доведеться жити поруч з сусідом, у якого мозки трошки повернуті не в той бік. Тому нам треба зрозуміти, що якщо все суспільство має, що все суспільство має переорієнтуватися на режим еволюційного виживання. Інакше ми будемо лікувати ногу, замотуючи її бінтиком, а тоді, коли її вже треба відрізати, чи сепсис якийсь почався, чи ще якась біда почалася. Ось така думка. Дякую.
Well, with that, obviously this is an issue that inspires controversy, a lot of heated opinions, but that's the whole point of the event tonight, was to get people to start talking about this. Because if you ignore the problem or you pretend like it doesn't exist, it's just going to get worse. So it's great that you all were here. I think it's a really encouraging sign. I think all of us were flattered that this many people showed up and were interested in this topic. So thank you all for being here, and yeah, hopefully we see you all again soon.
Thank you.
Just really quick, everyone, I hope you all got lots of ideas, so please connect with each other, and I hope this conversation continues. We are closing the building, though, in 15 minutes, so just to let you know.